Hi, I'm Virgil. Welcome to my YouTube channel. I want to talk about a piece of equipment that I've been promising to post on YouTube, and it's a Luxman M120a power amplifier. I've had this power amplifier for about 3.5 years ago, and it's about time to bring it out from under the bed in the next room and replace it and put it in the rack over here for this Luxman M2000 power amp with the big VU meters. Before I get started, I'd like to give a shout out to some folks. Somebody that wanted me to post this on YouTube, and I got a request through a Facebook website for Luxman users. I want to give a shout out to Christian Rosengard, and then some guys that I kind of correspond with since we're all Luxman users, Sean McNamara and Jerry Grajewski. So a big shout out to you guys. Another supporter I want to talk about is Frank Landry, channel 33 RPM. Frank runs a YouTube channel where he does Friday Night Vinyls, where he reviews vinyl records that he's bought or maybe somebody sent to him. And then usually every Sunday, he does about an 8 to 10 minute segment covering whatever topics that are current regarding vinyl gear and more. So I'll put a link down below in the comments section for Frank Landry's channel 33 RPM. The purpose of today's video obviously is to bring this out and meet a requirement that I want to use it again and test it out. But before that, I want to make sure that it's working and it's clean. So I haven't cleaned it probably for over 3 years, and it's been sitting under the bed covered up, obviously in a bag, for about a year and a half. So what we hope to do with today's video is take you through, show you the features of this unique power amplifier, and then later on take it down to the laundry room where it's a little bit better ventilation, open it up inside and let you see what the design of this particular amp has, and then go through and clean the pots, you know, for these attenuators and switches, power switches, speaker connections, RCA, things like that. So that's kind of what we hope to focus on. So a little bit of history about this. Originally looking for this particular unit over here, the M120A, is kind of a substitute until I could find this M2000 power amp. This particular amp is rated at 120 watts at 8 ohms, and I found it on Craigslist in Van Nuys, California. So I live in the Los Angeles area. The owner actually had the matching C120A preamp, beautiful preamp, but he didn't want to sell that. The reason that he was selling this particular unit is he found a laboratory series Luxman 5M 21, I believe. Yeah, laboratory series amp at an estate sale, which is a very highly regarded amplifier. This particular one, he'd actually recapped himself. He went through a process. He actually gave me the documentation, and we'll open it up and I'll show you some of the capacitors and the rectifiers and things like that, so you can see what's been done. When I bought it with the understanding that this particular VU meter, the right one, was not working. The left one was functioning pretty well. Cosmetic condition, pretty darn good. I'd give it about a 90 to 95%. It's a beautiful amp, and like I say, it's produced probably between 1980 to 1984. So let's go ahead and take a closer look on the front and the back before we take it down for a good cleaning. So here we have a look at the front face of the M120A power amp. It's a beautiful design, and like I said before, it's built between 1980 to 1984. Had a matching preamplifier called the C120A, which I believe it had both a moving magnet and a moving coil capability. And then there was an equalizer called the G120A. So there was a three-component design for this particular series. You notice up here in the right-hand corner, it says a dual beta circuit, 1 amp per channel. It has a bridgeable mono using two of these amps if you want to go ahead and do it. And you notice over here you have your left channel and over here your right channel, but then you can set it up just for right channel on each particular separate M128 power amp. And up here you could see where you could run it up to 300 watts at 8 ohms per channel, meaning for each of the two separate power amps. These are LED VU meters. They're segmented into 10 different sections. You have your attenuators, which allow you to control the amount of power that's going to the speakers. You have a power indicator where you can set up for full power and see the actual output. You can turn it off so they're not playing at all. And then you could set up for 1/100th as well. For speakers, you can set up for main and you could set for remote. So if you had like four speakers, for example, and then if you put it in the middle, you can listen to all of them at the same time. So I have the power and then a phone. This one I like for headphones, this particular power amp compared to the M2000, the one with the big VU meters, it doesn't have a headphone jack that actually goes through another preamp function. So let's go ahead and take a look at the backside. Here's the backside of the power amp. Let's go over a few areas and I'll kind of explain the difference between the setting the amp up just for stereo or for mono. Over here on the left hand side, we've got the inputs leading to your preamp for both stereo. And if you want to use this as a separate amp, but you have two of them, then you would just make connections to the right channel over here. We have our speaker terminals that we would normally use hooking up our speakers for main speakers, both for the right and for the left. And then you could also set up remote speakers as well. And I mentioned the switch on the front where you could set for main, for remote, or for both. These speaker terminals are a little bit of a problem. They stick a lot. It's hard to get a large gauge wire in there. Normally end up putting like 16 gauge wire. Hope to do some cleaning on this and take care of those kind of things too. There's a switch up here. You can leave it in normal stereo mode, or if you have two separate amps, then you flip it over and use each amp, one for each channel. And then finally over here is your connections that go out to your speakers. In other words, if you have one, you could go to the like the left speaker and unscrew these, put your wire connections over here, and the same would be done on the corresponding amp for the other channel. And again, you would end up having for both of these the right connection to the preamp. All right, and then what I want to kind of show you is here's the owner's manual. Kind of gives you an idea of the back of the amplifier, and then up here, obviously for the preamp, which looks like the C120A preamp, and then your connections for setting up as two separate amps. Over here, you've got your connections coming out, just like I was explaining over here, going to your speaker, and this will be done twice, obviously, because you have two separate amps. So that's kind of an overview of the backside of the power amp. Let's go ahead and head on down to the laundry room and set this up and prepare to take the case off and take a look inside. Let's go. All right, I brought the amp down to the laundry room, and now is the time to open her up, take a look at the inside build of the power amplifier, and look at some of the capacitors that have been replaced by the previous owner. But to start out, first, a couple things about safety. Being a former industrial arts teacher, we always preach safety. So obviously you want to make darn sure the unit's unplugged. Obviously it hasn't been used for like over a year and a half, but there are capacitors and there's like a big rectifiers inside. And sometimes you got to be careful. Those could still hold charges and you don't want to get your hands in there and get shocked. I've cleaned maybe about two receivers since I've been retired, three preamps, and now working on this amplifier. One thing that I was trying to learn how to do is clean and service these kind of pieces of stereo equipment, and I'll post this online, but it was available through audiokarma.com. iMovie.org. It's called The Idiot's Guide to Using Deoxit Revisited. Okay, so I've used this. It's about maybe 5 or 6 pages, and I'm going through the processes. It talks about removing the top cover. Obviously, I'll be removing the case. There might be a bottom cover. I don't know. We'll take a look at it. Probably won't have to deal with anything on the faceplate. I've pulled these knobs off. You can see the actual pot itself, but there's no access in terms of providing cleaning fluids and things like that. We're going to be working on the pots, the switches, and so forth. Since I've been working on some of the equipment, I've accumulated a few things. Like I said, I recently bought a new can of Deoxit D5 that I'll be using to deoxidize switches, pots, and so forth. I bought Deoxit Gold G5, which kind of treats some of the surfaces after you're done. On some of the other equipment, I've had sliders, like on a preamp, for example, and they call Fader Lube F5, so I've used that. Sometimes you get some dusty internals on these amps and preamps, so I've gone and bought several canisters of air. A whole bag of stuff I'll probably never use all the time. These pipe cleaners, and I like these wooden type Q-tip swabs for getting into a couple of different areas. I've also bought, rather than just can, Deoxit. Almost looks like fingernail polish. So I'll be using some of those, maybe on the back side, or maybe over here on the headphone jack. I do have some Mother's Mag and aluminum polish. I won't be using it on the face of this particular amp, but I have used it on the platter on my turntable. And then there's some other things like brushes and things to kind of go in and clean open holes for like RCA connectors. And it's always good to have a flashlight so you can look inside. So those are some of the things. And then sometimes when I get done working with a piece of equipment, one of the reasons I like Luxman equipment is the casing. Now this one is obviously plastic, a plastic veneer over the top. But some of the other pieces of the Luxman equipment I have are rosewood. And so I ended up using Howard's feed and wax to kind of replenish and refresh the surfaces of those component cabinets. So let's go ahead and take a look inside, and we'll take the cover off. Okay, so I've just got to remove 6 screws, and so we'll go ahead and do that. All right, here's the amp after being removed from the case. And again, I just kind of set the case off to the side. We'll put her back together in a few minutes or so forth. But we have a couple of unique features on this one. Over here we have some what they call heat pipes with cooling fins, a little bit different than my earlier M2000, which had a couple of big heat sinks on the outside that were cast aluminum and milled and very efficient in terms of cooling off that other amp. If we look down at the bottom down here, we got the power transformer, the two rectifiers, and again, they're new within the last three and a half years. Okay, and then over here we've got our right and left LED indicators, power indicators, the boards for those. And if we look inside, we might be able to see some of the work that the previous owner performed. Let's see if I can zoom in a little bit. Yeah, you can see some of the newer capacitors that are over here. And I think I have a flashlight. Maybe I can light up some more over here as well. Yeah, there's one in the back that's kind of green and so forth, and you see them over here as well. Okay, so all the new caps have been replaced, and it's pretty clean inside. I didn't actually have to use any canned air to go ahead and try to clean that stuff out. So looks in pretty good shape. And so let's go ahead and start to identify some of those things that have to be cleaned with Deoxit D5. if you look very close, way in the back, we obviously have two attenuators. This is the front over here. So we've got the first attenuator over here and the pots there. And then there's another one down below. And later on, we'll take a look at the switches and deal with those. So let me go ahead and see if I can get a closer look and closer view so you can see that. Okay, let's go ahead and take care of those attenuators. You'll see a couple of pots here kind of by the straw. There's one attenuator right there in the light, and then the bottom one. Okay, and you see the slots on the pots themselves. So go ahead and take a shot there. Throw a little light on it. Shoot some in there. Shoot some in there. And then just work those pots back and forth. I don't know, maybe 20, 30 times. Work that deoxit in there. There might be an additional slot on the other side of the pot that you could shoot as well, but I'll just work that. Okay, so I'll come back and kind of put another 10 or 20 turns on that. But for now, let's go ahead and move up and see if we can go take care of that power switch. It gets way up there. There it is. Yeah, this particular power switch over here. And we'll get that lubed up as well. So let's go ahead and take a little bit of light there. Take a couple of shots. And then just work it back and forth. Okay, clean up that particular switch. And we should be set okay there. All right, so work some more of that, and then we'll get to the next section, which is to deal with switches. Okay, now we're taking a look at the switches, and sorry for the shakiness, but if I have to zoom in pretty close. Got two switches, got one on the bottom. I'm trying to use a light. And if I move the switch, can you see the parts that are actually moving? And the metal contacts, so we don't need to get some deoxit in there. So let's see if I can do that. Get a couple blasts, and then just work that back and forth, okay? And there's probably more contact area in the back, but for now, I think you get the picture. And I'll repeat the same process for the one above. All right, so far we've cleaned a power switch and two attenuators, and then these switches for the speakers and things like that. Okay, after using Deoxit D5 on the front switches and pots and so forth, I've got a can of Deoxit F5 fader lube, and it's good for things like plastic to metal and so forth. It's more of a lubricant, so I could go ahead and spray some of these same areas, obviously, and then go ahead and do the switch down below as well. Whoop. Oh, overkill. But anyway, I can add that as a little bit of a lubrication, especially for those things dealing with metal or plastic. All right, so I've done some fader lube, and that kind of takes care of the front part. I will take care of that headphone jack as well. Okay, now for the headphone jack and maybe some of the connections on the back, I have this little bottle similar to like Deoxit D5, and comes with a brush. So I'm just gonna go ahead and kind of put some on the inside a little bit, work it around, maybe even put some on a Q-tip a little bit. I don't know if I can get that Q-tip in there, might be too much, but we'll see. And then just kind of work it inside. All right, there might be a lot of dust and other crap in there. And we kind of want to work that out. So it's good for metal surfaces. And then we'll clean it up a little bit. All right, we'll probably do something similar to the back on the RCA jacks. Let's take a look at the back now. Okay, we're looking at the back side, and maybe the first thing we'll take care of is this switch that allows you to go between stereo and mono. So let's take a zoom inside and see that switch from the inside. Okay, now we're taking a look at the switch. It's a little dark there. Can you see it if I work it back and forth a little bit? Okay, so let's go ahead and spray a little bit of D5 in there. All right, work that switch back and forth. And again, I'll come back to that and add some fader lube to that as well. Okay, so we got that one done. Good.
All right, let's try to wrap up the back side here. We'll start off with these
RCA phono jack. So what I'll go ahead and do is put some of the red, Deoxit red in there, a little bit, work it around. And then I've got some other tools I can use. I thought I'd show you what I got as part of a kit that came with that. You know, you have these like little brushes and stuff, and foam tip covers and things. So I'll just go ahead and work that in, clean it up a little bit. Okay. Yeah, I don't think I can get a Q-tip in that, but that should be cleaned up pretty well. All right, I've unscrewed all of the speaker connectors for both the main and the remotes, and then for the mono as well. I won't go in very close, but as you look down in here, there's actually like a hole that you could actually put the end of a speaker wire, maybe 16 gauge down in there, and then screw it in for one particular speaker. All right, so let's go ahead and see what we can try to do. I've never thought much about this, but I'm just gonna go ahead and shoot some D5 in all of these. Let it sit a little bit. Okay. And then I'm gonna go ahead and work them back and forth. It's kind of boring, so I'll cut from there. We'll just, again, they're very tight. They seem to be working a little bit better already. Yeah, just working them. Yeah. And I'll work them back and forth. All right, and the same thing with these big mono output. Oh, a lot better, a lot better. Okay, good, good. So I've got that all done. So I got our speaker connectors kind of clean. And the input jacks, RCA connectors, and so forth. So, gee whiz, I think that's about it. So what I want to do is, just to be safe, some people say, you know, hey, you can fire this puppy up maybe in an hour or 2 hours. I'm going to actually let it dry overnight because I probably sprayed about $3 or $4 worth of Deoxit all over that cardboard. So let's go ahead and set it overnight, let it dry out. I'll wipe it down a little bit, and we'll put it back in the case and hook her up, see how she runs, okay? All right. Oops, almost forgot. I did clean the insides of these RCA connectors, but I didn't do anything for the outside surface. So I just want to point that out. I do have some Deoxit Gold G5 for gold metal or gold-plated surfaces, so kind of do it real quick and dirty. Sorry. There we go. And then I can treat the outside of those as well. Kind of quick and dirty, but it'll do. All right, so you kind of get the picture. Try to use all my different products and get the job done. So we'll see what happens when we put it back together. Well, it's the next morning. Looked like all the Deoxit that was sprayed all over the amp and onto the cardboards evaporated. It looks kind of nice and clean. So let's go ahead and take a moment to put this thing back together, and we'll get it back into service. Well, I've got her all back together. She's looking good, and let's take her back to the music room and hook it up and see how she works. Well, there's the M120A. I brought it back up from the laundry room, and we're gonna take a little time out here to swap it out with that big VU metered M2000 Luxman power amp. So give me a few minutes, I'll be right back. Okay, I've removed the Luxman M2000 and placed it to the left of the M120A. You can see the difference in the depth of the cabinet. And as I mentioned earlier in the video, all these big heat sinks on the back. And you look at the speaker connections. Yeah, they're pretty big heat sinks. And then you look at the connections and so forth that you've seen before. More of a screw type, okay? And then the difference in weight, especially with those heat sinks on the M2000. So you can see there's a little bit of difference in poundage. All right, let's go ahead and put that M120A in. Well, here we go. I've got the M120A back in the rack, replacing the M2000. And I did a little cleaning of the preamp above. I had some issues with the volume pot seeming to be a little scratchy and a few other things. So I cleaned that up before I put it all back together. So let's go ahead and give it a listen. And I'll start off
with some 1960 version of 6i pressing from Columbia. Timeout with Dave Brubeck, a little bit of take five. So let's see what she sounds like. You can see the left and right VU meters, the LED meters working. Imagine the screen will be vibrating a little bit from the bass. Well, looks like she's working. Everything's in order. So thanks for watching this video. Hope you learned something. And maybe you want to tackle some cleaning of your equipment as well. So tune in next time to my channel. Maybe I'll do a segment on the M2000. Thanks for watching.